Hello everyone, welcome to our channel. We are going to solve GATE 2013 questions and we will discuss the answers of this. So we will first see physical metallurgy part. This is the first question. The first question says the critical value of the Gibbs energy of nucleation at equilibrium temperature is, right? So it is basically asking you about the critical value of Gibbs free energy of nucleation. So guys, we know during nucleation the free energy, suppose we consider the nuclei to be of sphere, right? So it is 4 pi r square gamma s at surface area into this surface energy per unit area plus the volume 4 by 3 pi r cube and your free energy per unit volume, right? And this is your total free energy for this nucleation. Now guys, when we find this r radius r star, then we get it minus 2 gamma s by delta gb, right, which tells you about this critical radius of nucleation. And the question, it is asking about the critical value of the Gibbs energy. So how we can find this critical energy? We will find if you put the r value as r star, right? So 4 pi minus 2 gamma s by delta gb square into gamma s plus 4 by 3 pi r, r is your minus 2 gamma s by delta gb cube into delta gb, right? So this is the expression to find the critical value of Gibbs energy. Now if you see the value, it is 16 by 3 pi gamma s cube by delta gb square, right? So this is your critical value of the Gibbs energy and this is asking you at equilibrium, right? So what is the value at equilibrium? So what is the meaning of equilibrium is that the nucleation is happening at the melting point, just at the melting point. So guys, how do you find this delta gb? There is one more expression, delta gb you find using delta hv t minus tm by tm. Delta gb is equal delta hv t minus tm. So how it comes? We know delta H, delta G is equal to delta H minus T delta S. And we write at melting point, just at melting point, we can write like this. So delta H Tm minus T by Tm. Right? So at equilibrium, this temperature is equal to Tm. So that's why the free energy, at that the free energy per unit volume will be 0. So it will be something like 16 by 3 pi gamma cube gamma s cube by 0. So how much it will be? It will be infinite, right? So the critical value of Gibbs energy of nucleation is infinite at equilibrium temperature, guys. Now what is the physical meaning of this delta G star when it is on infinite? That means we need, if you see the diagram, we need infinite energy for this nucleation to happen, right? If you see the nucleation diagram, so this is for surface, right? And suppose this is for volume. And this is the common diagram. Suppose this is the common diagram. So this is your delta G star. Now in this case, delta G star is infinite. That means you can consider this one as something like this. It is very large, very large, going to the infinite. That means huge amount of energy is required. That means it is not going to happen any nucleation. Right? So that's why, guys, nucleation never happens just equal to the melting point. It has to have some amount of decrease in temperature from the nucleation temperature, the melting temperature. It has to decrease from the melting temperature, maybe in a very small amount, suppose 0.0001 Kelvin. But this amount of temperature decrease is required for this nucleation to happen, right? So this is the thing, right? Okay, so the answer shall be infinite. Okay, next question. With respect to the matrix of aluminium copper alloy, GP Jones are, right? This is your aluminium copper. What we do? We initially do the annealing process, that is called as solution annealing, right? Now if you see this aluminium copper phase diagram, so it is something like this. It is around, I guess, 4.3% or what. Exactly, I don't know. But it is something like this. So when we keep it at this temperature, so at this temperature, this copper is dissolved in aluminium, right? Now when we bring this temperature down, so what happens at this room temperature, the copper solubility is less. This is your copper solubility, right? This is your copper solubility. Once, due to this fast quenching, the more amount of copper becomes soluble. So that tries to get out from this aluminium matrix. So when it tries to get out, then initially what happens? Some atoms of copper are formed. These are atoms of copper are formed. And these atoms of copper are basically called as your GP zone. So when this copper atoms are formed, so this copper has got FCC structure and the base is of aluminium, which is also of FCC structure. So there will be what? There will be coherency because the both structures are of same type, right? So the GP zones are of coherent nature. Yes. Well, other options, if you see, incoherent, wrong. Semi-coherent, wrong. Chemically indistinguishable, wrong. You can distinguish this one, copper and aluminum. So this option D is also incorrect. Next, which one of the following techniques does not require quenching to obtain final case hardness? So guys, which of the following techniques does not require quenching? So when we do quenching, quenching we do in the case of steel to produce martensite, right? So when we try to form martensite, and guys, we know the martensite of some composition 0.2% greater than 0.28% in plain carbon steel has got some hardness, means the strength of 0.2% weight percent or greater than 0.2% weight percent has got more hardness, right? So guys, so when we produce martensite, when we have a steel and where we certainly have some amount of carbon over here, right? So after this carburizing process, what we do, we try to diffuse carbon at the surface, and this carbon, the enriched carbon, when we do quenching, so it converts this portion into your martensite. So this carburizing process requires quenching. But here in the option, the question, it is asked which of the following process does not require quenching, right? So guys, flame hardening, if you see, so flame hardening is done in steel which contains some carbon, right? So this will not be the answer. Induction hardening, same case. Carburizing, same case. So the only option is nitriding. So what we do in the case of nitriding, we diffuse nitrogen, right, into the steel surface. So when we diffuse this nitrogen, so what happens, there's certain nitrides are formed like FeN, Fe2N, right, something like this. So these are the nitrides which are formed, and other than this nitrides, some aluminium nitrides are formed, some vanadium nitrides are formed, right? So these directly helps to increase the strength, because these nitrides have got higher hardness, and these nitrides also makes the path of dislocation motion difficult. Yeah, which one of the following elements is an austenite stabilizer? It is asking for the austenite stabilizer. We know austenite is of FCC, and we also know that FCC element helps to do the stabilization. So through this, we, if you think, then nitrogen, molybdenum, vanadium, tungsten, so these all are of BCC nature, so these do not do your austenite stabilization. And we have studied that nitrogen helps in stabilization of this gamma phase. Along with nitrogen, carbon also helps in this stabilization. Then nickel helps, copper helps, and these are of FCC nature, right? Carbon, although it is not of FCC nature, you see the, what is the crystal structure of carbon? So it is like diamond cubic, if you see in the case of diamond, right? And basically carbons exist in different forms, right? Suppose graphite, you look, so hexagonal structure is there, right? So these helps in this gamma stabilization. Okay, a 0.2 weight percent plain carbon steel sheet is heated and equilibrated in the intercritical region, followed by instant water quenching. The microstructure of the quenched steel consists of, okay, so guys, here the steel is being heated in the intercritical region. So what is the meaning of this intercritical region? If you see from the phase diagram, then this is your 0.02, this is your 0.8, then this is somewhat 2.1, right? And here it is talking about 0.2 weight percent. So this is your hypotactoid steel. So the 0.2% would be lying like this. Suppose this is your 0.28%. So what is the intercritical region? It is region between AC1 and AC3. So what is AC1? AC1 is your eutectoid temperature, and AC3 line is the line between gamma and this phase, alpha plus gamma phase. So this region. So this region consists of what? Alpha plus gamma, right? Okay, so when we have this alpha plus gamma, and this alpha which is present, and this is formed above eutectoid temperature, so this is called as pro-eutectoid ferrite, right? And when we do the quenching process, so gamma will transform into martensite, and this pro-eutectoid ferrite, whatever it was formed, so that will remain in the pro-eutectoid ferrite phase. So the final structure will be of alpha plus gamma, and this alpha is your pro-eutectoid ferrite, right? So So which is the option? The option is protected ferrite and martensite. Option B, right? Let us move. The atomic packing fraction of diamond cubic structure is. So what is the atomic packing fraction of diamond cubic structure? It is 0.34, right? So you all remember this. Now let us move to two mass question. The first question: a unit cell of an element has maximum linear density along the 1-1-0 direction. The packing density of its 1-0-0 plane is. Okay, so here is a trick, because it has not directly given what is the crystal structure, so that we will use the concept where we will find the number of atoms and do the calculation, right? So, but it has given you information. What is the information? A unit cell of an element has maximum linear density along the 1-1-0 direction, right? Suppose I draw a unit cell . This is your x, y and z, suppose. Then 1-1-0 direction shall be this, right? So among simple cubic, BCC and FCC, which one has the maximum linear density among along this 1-1-0 direction? So if you think, then you will get the answer that it is FCC, right? So in the FCC case, the slip direction, we know that has got the maximum linear density. So this slip direction in FCC is your 1-1-0, right? And what is your slip plane? Slip plane is 1-1-1. And what is your slip direction? It is 1-1-0, right? Everyone clear? Okay, so this is your FCC. Now here it is asking that the packing fraction of its 1-0-0 plane, right? Now if you see this 1-0-0 plane, then this is your 1-0-0 plane. Now if I extrapolate, if I take this plane out of this and draw over here, then it would be looking like this, where I will have four atoms at the four corners and there will be one atom at the center, right? So the packing density of its 1-0-0 plane is. So it is asking for the packing density, right? Yes, everyone. So how will you find? So this is in the 2D diagram, right? 2D diagram. So how we will use this packing density is that we'll find the area enclosed by this atoms. These are the four atoms at the corners and one is this. So we'll find the area occupied. So how much, the first we can find using this effective number of atoms. So how much will be the effective number of atoms? So it will be 4 into 1/4, because 1/4 contribution here, yeah, plus 1, so it will be 2, right? So we can find area 2 into pi r square. And what is the relation between r and a? And we know r is equal to root 2a by 4. So we can put here 2 into pi root 2a by 4 whole square, right? And what is the complete area of this plane? It is a into a, that is a square, right? So packing efficiency for this 2D will be 2 into pi into root 2a by 4 whole square divided by a square. So it will be 2 into 3.14 into 2 by 16, yeah, so it is 3.14 divided by 4, 3.14 divided by 4, it is 0.785, right? So when we see this answer, then it is 0.68, 0.75, 0.79. So it is matching with this answer, right? So this will be your answer. Okay, everyone, fine. Next, for an FCC metal, the ratio of interplanar spacing obtained from the first two peaks of the X-ray diffraction pattern is. Okay, guys, so for FCC, what is the n value for which we get the diffraction? And this n value is nothing but your h square plus k square plus l square, right? So we know and we remember it is 3, 4, then 8, then 11, 12, right? So the first two peaks will be 3 and 4. And guys, we know this d, that interplanar distance, is equal to a by root over h square plus k square plus l square. Right? So it is asking the ratio of interplanar spacing obtained from first two peaks. So d of first peak will be a divided by root over first peak, it will be 3, right? So a by root 3 we can write. Now d for the second peak, d for second peak will be a divided by root over 4. So d of first peak divided by d of second peak will be a by root 3 into a by root 4. That will be root over 4 by 3. And if you find this root over 4 by 3, right, everyone? So which is the correct option? Option D is your correct one. Next question. Saturation. Saturation magnetization of an FCC metal with lattice parameter 0.2 mm is 600 kilo ampere per meter. The net magnetic moment per atom is given by, in Bohr magneton we need to find. So guys, here it is given for FCC metal and whose lattice parameter is 0.2. FCC one and lattice parameter, that is A is equal to 0.2 nanometer. Okay, fine. And the magnetization is 600 kilo ampere per meter. The net magnetic moment per atom is given by. So guys, we need to remember this formula, that is MS, that is saturation magnetization is given by NB, number of Bohr magneton, into mu B, this the value of Bohr magneton, and N. N is your number of atoms per unit volume. So from here, if you see the value, it is 600 kilo ampere per meter is equal to NB is your magnetic moment per unit per atom. So it will be equal to NB, which we need to find, and the value of mu B, right, the value of mu B is 9.27 into 10 to power minus 24 ampere meter square per Bohr magneton. It's for one magneton value, right, into N. N is your how much, the number of atoms will be here 4, right? So 4 divided by this complete area, so area will be, this is your 4 atoms, right, and the area will be 0.2 cube into 10 power minus 27. So this NB equal to 600 kiloampere. So 600 into 1000, 0.008 we can write, to 10 power minus 27 divided by 9.27 into 10 power minus 24. So this we can write here. Here it shall also be into 4, right? That I left. So guys, if you find the answer, it will be 0.129. Right, everyone? So this NV value is 0.129, that gives you magnetic moment per atom, and it is, the unit of this is Bohr magnetron. Okay, fine. And next, this is a common data type question, right? So here, steel specimen containing 0.2 weight percent carbon is carburized in an atmosphere that maintains a carbon content of 1.2 weight percent at the surface of the specimen, right? It is given. Now for carbon diffusion in austenite, D naught is 2.0 × 10⁻⁵, and activation energy for diffusion, that is Q, is equal to 142 kilojoule per mole. And guys, here we have a table where we get the Y value and corresponding error function value, right? So what is the depth in micrometer from the surface of the specimen at which a composition of 0.4 weight percent carbon is obtained after carburizing at 870 degrees centigrade for 10 hours? Okay, so guys, for this, let me add a slide over here so that I can solve. Okay. So this is your initial composition, 0.2 weight percent, and what is the surface composition? It is 1.2 weight percent, right? So in the case of carburizing, what is the solution for the diffusion? It is Cx minus C naught by Cs minus C naught is equal to 1 minus error function x by 2 root tt. Yes, everyone, this is the formula. Clear? Now, so from this we understand how the composition profile goes. It goes something like this. This is your C naught, this is your Cs, this is your Cs, and at some distance x, this will be your Cx, right? Fine. So guys, here it is given, the Cx value is also given. So what is the depth from the surface at which we get a composition of 0.4? So we'll put in the formula, it will be 0.4 minus C naught is your 0.2, Cs is your 1.2, C naught is your 0.2. So it will be 1 minus error function x by 2 root tt. Right? So if you quickly find this ratio, it will be 1 by 5. So 1 by 4, and take this 1 value. 1 by 5 minus 1 equal to minus error function x by 2 root over dt. This will be 4 by 5 is equal to error function x by 2 root over dt. And what is 4 by 5? It is 0.80 equal to error function x by 2 root over dt. Right? And so guys, we will see, we will have to find from the table which is the suitable value of this x by 2 root over dt such that we get 0.80. So guys, from the table, if you see, we have got 0.80, right? That is error function of x by 2 root over dt is equal to 0.80. So we'll have to equate this one with error function y is equal to 0.80. So which is the option which is matching in this column? So this is the closest one, right? So since this is the closest one and we have the options over here, so we can find the closest value, right? So this will take, so what is the y value at which we get error function y is equal to 0.8? It is 0.9, right? So from this we know this y is equal to 0.9. That means x by 2 root over dt is equal to 0.9. So this we will use here. So x by 2 root over dt is equal to 0.9. So this implies x equal to 0.9 into 2, and this d value, d will be what? D naught e to the power minus q by rt and into time t, right? And let us see what are the given value. The temperature is given 870 and it is for 10 hours. And d naught is also given and the q value is also given. So we'll put all this value, no problem. It will be 0.9 into 2. D naught is how much? 2.0 into 10 power minus 5. 2.0 into 10 power minus 5 to the power minus q. Q is how much? 142 kilojoule. So 142,000, right? What is R value? 8.314. Temperature is 870, right? So 870, we need to convert this into Kelvin. So 870 plus 273, how much it will be? 1143. So we'll put here 1143. And what is the time over here? Time is 10 hours, right? Everyone. So 10 hour, how we'll convert this into second? So it will be 10 into 60 into 60, right? So this is the expression. Now if you find this expression, so let me do the calculation. I am doing it. It is your 8.69 into 10 power minus 4 meter, right? So x we can write 869 micrometer, right? Can you write this? Yes. Now let us see the option. The options are 1584, 113, 875. So it is closest to this, right? So it shall be 875. Now in the next question, how long in hour will it take to double the depth at which 0.48% is reached, right? So guys, in this question, it is asking what is the time required to double the length at which double the depth at which 0.48% is reached. Okay. So this Cx value, C naught value, Cs C naught will be same, right? So there will be two situations. So we can use this equation, that is x by 2 root over dt is equal to constant. Right? So guys, in the first case, we have got x is equal to some constant 2 root over d into time t1, right? In the second case, we need to double this. So 2x1 equal to k, 2 root over d will be same because temperature is same. And guys, we need to find this t2, right? T2. Now if you divide both, then it will be 1 by 2 is equal to root over t1 by t2. So simple. So this will be 104 is equal to And what is your T1? It is 10 hours. So 10 divided by T2. So what is your T2? T2 will be how much? 40 hours. Right? So this is also very simple question. So it will be your 40 hours. So option A. Right? Everyone? Now let us move to last question. This is the last question. The density and associated crystallinity for two polypropylene samples are as follows. The density is given in the left side and the right side crystallinity. The density of totally amorphous polypropylene is. Okay, for this let us add some slides. Because this is a lengthy question, right? Okay, so here it is asking for density of totally amorphous polypropylene, right? So for this problem, what we'll do? Here two conditions are given, 1.20 density, 1.44, and percentage crystallinity there. So we'll take both equation and we'll divide this, right? So when we divide this, we can easily find this rho a value, the amorphous, totally amorphous one. So first we'll see what is the formula for crystallinity. It is rho s minus rho a divided by rho s in the numerator, and the denominator it is rho c minus rho a by rho c into 100, where your rho s is your what sample, rho a is equal to amorphous and rho c is equal to crystalline. 100% crystalline density. These are all density. So first we will see the first one. First case, what shall be? You can write 1.2 minus rho A by 1.2 divided by rho C minus rho A by rho C into 100 is equal to your 50. This is your first equation. What shall be the second equation? 1.44 minus rho a by 1.44 divided by rho c minus rho a by rho c into 100 is equal to 80%. So this is your second one. So we'll divide both, right? It is so simple. So now if you divide both, then it comes 1.2 minus rho a by 1.2 divided by 1.44 minus rho a by 1.44 is equal to 50 by 80, right? So now if you do for the calculation, so how you can write 1.44 into 1.2 minus rho a divided by 1.44 minus rho a is equal to 5 by 8. Now if you do the further rearrangement, you do it by yourself, and I will tell you the last step. It is 5.18 is equal to 5.52 rho a. Okay. So rho a will be 0.938, right? The 0.938 will be how much? It is close to option D, because here we are getting rho a, that is for totally amorphous one, right? Yeah, fine. Now the second case, the percentage crystallinity of polypropylene sample having a density of 1.3 gram per centimeter cube, right? So it is asking for another case where 1.3. So what is the percentage crystallinity, right? So guys, in the percentage crystallinity formula, if you see the sample density, then your amorphous one, then sample, it is fine. Then we need to know this rho c value also, right? So guys, we have found this rho a value. So how we can find this rho c value? We'll put this rho a value in any one equation, either one or two. Suppose I put it in one equation, question number one. So it will be rho s is how much in equation 1? It is 1.2. 1.2 minus rho a, it is 0.938, right, divided by 1.2, and this rho c minus rho a, 0.938, this rho c into 100 is equal to 50, right. So guys, from here you can easily find this rho c value. Yes, now guys, so this will be something like this: 1.2 minus 0.938 by 1.2 is equal to half rho c minus 0.938 by rho c. So if you find further, then rho c is equal to 1.66. I have done the calculation previously. Okay, so this is your rho c value, right? So we have got this rho c value, this rho a value, right? So what is the case in the question? It is for density 1.3, right? So now for the next one, we'll use the same formula. So here the sample density shall be how much? It shall be 1.3. Rho c is 1.66. Let me check. Yes, rho c is 1.66. Now if you find this, then the answer you will get as 63.7%, right? Now let us see the option. 63.7, it is close to 64, right? So the correct answer will be 64. Yes. Okay guys, so these were the some physical metallurgy question. Hope you will like this video and it will help you for your GATE preparation.